Okay, mesdames. So welcome, bienvenue to this IHL talk. I'm Robert Roth, director of the Geneva Academy, and it's my pleasure to host you for this conference. I would like to thank first the Human Rights Institute of the International Bar Association, which is our partner for this talk. The institute is represented here by Ms. Natasha Brack, who will tell some words during the short break during the conference. And on the side of the Academy, who is also a partner to this talk, I would like to thank very warmly Carlos, Sibylle Rivera, and Anissa Belal, who is the organizer of the series of talks, and Carlos has been very instrumental in organizing this one, and very efficient, I must say. Thank you, Carlos. As a way of introduction, simply to record for the majority of you, that we are dealing with the so-called triple IM. So triple I will be I will use triple I, it's not very easy, but nevertheless, which means international, independent, and impartial mechanism on Syria, which was established by the resolution 71248 of the UN General Assembly and the Security Council, which is part of the discussion, but probably not for today, on the 21st of December 2016, and the date is also not completely innocent, but that's also another topic which will not be addressed. The resolution identifies two missions for the mechanism. First, collect, I put it shortly, collect, consolidate, preserve, and analyze evidence of violations and abuses during the Syrian conflict. Second, prepare files in order to facilitate and expedite fair and independent criminal proceedings in national and international tribunals. So two missions. Every single term, naturally, of the mission would deserve an analysis, but this is not an academic conference, so we will be more general and not specific in the discussion about the missions. The mechanism entails two important dimensions for Syria and for the international criminal justice system. First, for Syria. First comes Syria, the drama of the Syrian population, and if the mechanism can contribute to alleviate the sufferings of the population and give to this population some reasons for hope, its existence will be more than justified. Secondly, on international criminal justice, it's a new tool, and that's why it's very exciting for criminal lawyers like myself. Before that, and to put it too simply, but the way it was, you had commissions of inquiry, including on Syria, which were not judicial and very often ill-equipped to prepare, in quotation marks, evidence, a word that you have in the mission of the mechanism, evidence for tribunals, national and international tribunals. And the mechanism has introduced, for the first time, there is a kind of precedent with Guatemala, but it's a different situation, a quasi-prosecutorial instance, and here I quote, I think, the High Commissioner for Human Rights, which is tasked, not the commission, but the mechanism, which is tasked with the preparation of evidence for both national and international tribunals. The terms of reference add regional tribunals, but for criminal prosecutions, let's keep with national and international. This raises a series of questions, which I will refrain from introducing now, since it's not my role. My role is to give the floor to the three eminent speakers we have with us. So, we will hear first in two rounds, but every time, as first speaker, Ms. Michelle Jarvis, who is the deputy head of the mechanism, is a lawyer, and among other posts, she worked for 70 years at the ICY, International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia, most recently as deputy to the prosecutor. She has also worked as a legal practitioner in Australia and as a consultant for the UN Division for the Advancement of Women. Her areas of expertise include international criminal law, rule of law, capacity building, transitional justice, and gender. The second speaker will be Bénédicte de Morloz, who is a lawyer and head of the Investigations and Criminal Law Division at Trial in International. His team is conducting investigations on international criminal cases, including from Syria, and filing them before national prosecution authorities. He holds an LLM from the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, SOAS, and a Master of Laws from the University of Geneva. The first speaker is Mr. Ibrahim Aikasem. He's founding member of CISOS Files Group and is former speaker. He has been also a panelist at the Human Rights Council high-level panel discussions on violations on the human rights and of children in Syria, which took place 2 days ago. As a lawyer, he has defended detainees before Syrian courts and has been researching on the possibility of trial of war criminals in Syria in case of referral to the ICC. That's the presentation of the speakers. The first round will be general, and I will be perhaps more specific in the second round. I and the audience would like to hear your viewpoints on the mechanism. First, Michel Jarvis as the second key person of the mechanism, chief of the mechanism, then Benedict de Molloz as representative of a major NGO fighting against impunity, and thirdly, Ibrahim Aikasem as member of the Syrian civil society. It's my pleasure to give the floor to Michel.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure to be here. I'm still relatively newly arrived in Geneva, so wonderful to have an opportunity to come out to the academy here and meet with all of you today. Professor Roth, thank you also for the introduction. I think your remarks already set the scene quite well for what I'm going to say. And I will try to be relatively brief in this first round so that we have a chance for more specific questions and follow up later on. So what I really wanted to do was to set the scene a little bit about IIIM and to explain how we inside the mechanism, those staff members on board at this stage, see our mandate and some of the key challenges that we are grappling with. First of all, of course, I think that one of the challenges is to focus on the opportunities inherent in the IIIM's mandate instead of getting too caught up in what the IIIM is not. With a mandate like ours, of course, it's easy to focus on the fact that we're not a court or tribunal. We have no capacity to issue indictments or to prosecute cases. The IIIM, of course, will not render judgments. So it's very different from the models of international justice that we have seen before. It's not even a prosecution office, but as Professor Roth mentioned, it is being described as a quasi-prosecutorial office, which may already lead to some questions about what on earth does that mean, a quasi-prosecutorial office. Well, it really reflects the twin aspects of our mandate. So they are, just to remind you, to collect, consolidate, and preserve evidence of crimes committed in Syria since March 2011. And of course, in this aspect of the mandate, there is a big emphasis on the IIIM collecting, in the first instance, material that has already been collated by others. So we know that since the beginning of the events in Syria, many, many actors, civil society, other parts of the UN system, have been working diligently to try and document as much as possible the various violations. A huge amount of documentation already exists. We are in a new era in terms of social media, video images that are available from the conflict. So we start with the premise that this enormous body of material is out there. And so for IIIM, one of the first priorities is really putting in place the cooperation agreements and frameworks for us to access that material. We do anticipate, of course, that as we move forward with our analysis of what's been collected, we will have to do our own investigations in order to fill evidentiary gaps or to develop case files. But of course, initially, the emphasis is on taking stock of what is already there. The second aspect of the mandate, of course, is indeed to develop criminal case files that could be used as the basis for accountability processes either now, so that very much means the national jurisdictions who may be already working on Syria or who could work on Syria, Or, of course, the possibility of a future jurisdiction being created or indeed of an ICC referral. So the idea is to compile these case files that could then be used by others with jurisdiction now or in the future. So it is a novel mandate. It's not news for me to say it's very much born out of the deadlock in the Security Council over the last few years in terms of other accountability pathways. But there are some real opportunities inherent in this mandate. And for me, as somebody who's been following international criminal justice developments over the last two decades, I know there are many others in the room as well, I think there are some very important opportunities. The first one that I see is the fact that it's a mandate that very much recognises accountability is a process that needs contributions from a whole range of different jurisdictions at the national, international, and potentially even regional level. So with the ad hoc courts and tribunals set up in the 90s, of course, the starting point was justice should happen at the international level. Then over the years, we have seen a process whereby that has transitioned into continuation of justice at the national level in the countries of the former Yugoslavia, Rwanda, and elsewhere. So we are starting with this idea from the outset that this will be a combination of jurisdictions involved. The second thing is, of course, the real potential of an international mechanism like the IIIM to facilitate justice in other jurisdictions, and particularly at the national level. Again, the experience that we had in the ad hoc courts and tribunals was that because we had a mandate to take a big picture view of the conflict, of the actors, of the crime patterns committed, that when national systems were then seeking to follow up on more discrete aspects of the crimes, we could really assist in providing expertise, evidence, and also context for the work that they were doing. Of course, for IIIM, a very important part of our mandate will be our interactions with prosecutors at the national level and other law enforcement actors. And this is an issue that I think we'll come back to in subsequent rounds of the discussion. Another important aspect, important opportunity, is I think a very upfront recognition in the IIIM's mandate of the important role of civil society actors in the accountability process. Again, this is not new that civil society plays an important role, but I think this is really the first time we've seen in black and white in the mandate of a new international justice mechanism a reference to the need to coordinate and share information from those bodies. And then finally for me, I just wanted to raise the idea of, it is of course frustrating that there isn't an obvious jurisdictional pathway forward at this stage, but we also know just how much preparatory work goes into building complex international justice case files. So when you're talking about complex crime categories like crimes against humanity and war crimes, and when you're talking about very complex modes of liability like co-perpetration or joint criminal enterprise as we applied it in the ad hoc tribunals, or superior responsibility, there is an extensive amount of initial analysis, contextual work, building of expertise that needs to happen in order to get to the point where we can bring cases against those most responsible. So the idea of front-loading that work now, while we have the opportunity to collect the evidence in real time or within a reasonably short amount of time following the violations occurring, is a really important opportunity that should expedite processes for us later on when new jurisdictional pathways open up. So that's a few words about the mandate, how we see it, the opportunities. Maybe just a couple of very brief words on where we are at the moment with IIIM. Of course, you all know it was created a year ago by the General Assembly. It's also no surprise that it takes some time and effort to get a new institution up and running and to the point where it is fully operational. And this is particularly so in the UN system. We do work within a structure where recruitment and procurement of the infrastructure that we need doesn't necessarily happen quickly. So we have been working very creatively on ways of expediting that. I think we've made a lot of progress. We have currently around 20 staff members on board at IIIM. We anticipate when we're fully staffed that we will have around 60 staff members, so we're around a third at the moment. But we should be well positioned to proceed with recruitment quite rapidly from this point in time. I think it's interesting, especially for me coming in from the previous generations of courts and tribunals, some of our early recruitment has focused on professional categories like it's called now e-discovery, which was a new term to me, but basically these are experts who really understand technological processes and information management, again, with the reality that we will have a huge amount of documentation. A lot of it will be video and other images. We will need really state-of-the-art technological solutions. So we've been very much focusing on trying to map what we need. We have a very clear idea of that now. So we're moving forward with putting that process in place. Security, of course, is the other big issue. To ensure the integrity of our data is a massive priority so that we can now quickly start taking on board material. The other thing, of course, that we've been heavily focusing on is engagement with key interlocutors. So there's been extensive dialogue over the last 6 months with the document holders out there, the document collectors, Syrian civil society, the international civil society more generally, the Commission of Inquiry for Syria. Of course, it's mentioned in our terms of reference specifically. The expectation is that we will certainly be able to have access and take on board material that they have collected. I'm very happy to say that we have this morning signed a memorandum of understanding with the Commission of Inquiry. So again, this is another development that should enable us to move forward very expeditiously now into the substantive component of our work. The other thing, of course, is again the national law enforcement authorities, and we've been engaging both bilaterally with key interlocutors, but also importantly through the EU Genocide Network. This is the network hosted by Eurojust in The Hague, which meets twice a year and brings together the national war crimes officers from across Europe and also North America. So that's an important fora for us, and we've had good success so far in discussing within that context, and we will proceed ahead with that as a priority as well. So I will leave it there for now and hand over to my colleagues.
Thank you very much. I was already jealous before hearing you, but now I'm completely jealous of not being part of this mechanism. It's fascinating for a criminal lawyer.
Still hurrying.
But okay, let's forget it. And Benedict,
can you hear me?
Benedict, you have the floor.
Can you hear me well? Yeah. So they are still hiring. If you know.
Yeah. That's intense. Thank you. No, but it's too late for me, and it's too quick for them.
So hello everybody, very happy to be here as well, thank you very much for organizing this event. I'm happy to be with such a distinguished panelist and with my former law professor as well, so I hope I'm going to have a good grade at the end of this one. So I'm going to try and bring the NGO perspective. As some of you might know, Trial International is a Geneva-based actually NGO that fights impunity of the most heinous crimes. We also work on some Syrian cases. And well, for us, the creation of the IIIM was a very good news. It's actually the way that we see fighting against impunity, preparing case files and bringing them before the authorities. It's a very, we think, efficient tool to find the impunity of such heinous crimes, and for the Syrian context, where you have hundreds of thousands of international crimes committed, going around the deadlock of the Security Council was a very clever move, and so we really welcomed the creation of the IIIM. As Professor Roth was saying, it's a very different mechanism, because for now most UN fact-finding mission, they collect evidence, they do it, but then it's among others to publish reports. And the final destination is not the national prosecuting authorities. And here we have a very different system. If I If I make a parallel with the NGO world, you have NGOs that are really good at collecting evidence, documenting crimes, and then publishing reports. But a few NGOs also try to investigate, collect evidence in order to facilitate prosecution. That's actually what we do at Trial and other organizations such as ECCHR. Ibrahim is working with them. So we see the opportunities, but we also see the challenges of the IIIM that is going to face probably the mechanism in the following months, weeks, or years, or has already been facing maybe. First, I think that we need to manage the expectations in those type of cases, and with such a huge conflict, you have so many crimes and so many victims, and the IIIM will be very well staffed, but still, it will be impossible to deal with every single international crimes cases. And I think they made it quite clear also in the report to the Security Council that was just released on the webpage that there will need to be a selection of cases. And at our very modest level of that trial, we have also to do this selection. And it's often very difficult to explain because no victim is more important than another. But what you need to choose, in a way, is the case that you will be able to take to court. And the level is very high. A level of evidence is very high. To get a conviction, it's going to be very difficult for several reasons. First, you need a lot of evidence to prove that an alleged perpetrator is guilty. And this is already very difficult in common crimes cases. But there you have the police going to the scene, the crime scene, and interviewing the suspects, the witness. But there it's a whole different story because, I mean, for now, Syria is out of reach for the IIIM. So they will not be able, I hope in the future, but for now, able to go underground to collect the evidence. The witnesses, they are very difficult to reach as well. Many witnesses are scared. Their family might be still in Syria. So this is going to be a tough challenge, but selection of cases will be necessary. Talking about protection of witnesses, I think this is also a very difficult issue. As I was saying, people are scared, people are threatened, and you need to protect their identity and potentially to relocate some of the witnesses. And it's not going to be the task of the IIIM, who is a quasi-prosecuting authority, but not a prosecuting authority. So it's going to lie in the hands of the national prosecuting authority who are going to conduct the investigation. But there you have some issues because some of these prosecuting authorities, they don't have good witness protection scheme or incomplete one. So how are you going to protect the witness there? This is going to be, I think, a bigger challenge. And I think that the IIIM will need a lot of internal resources to be able to assess prior to filing cases what are the possibilities in terms of witness protection. Witness protection means security issue. As Michel was saying, is top priority. And you know that the contenders of the IIIM are no lightweights. You have Syria, you have also Russia, and the other allies. And in terms, for instance, of cybersecurity, these people can be quite aggressive. There is a case right now before the French prosecuting authorities against Cosmos. Cosmos is a French company who provided a surveillance mechanism to the Syrians, and they were able to crack Skype and other form of communication of dissidents. So they are quite strong with this. And if you have a leak, you put in danger the security of potential witness and of victims. So I think they will need to gear up and to be very strong. And I understand that it's a top priority. So that's great. Maybe a last point touching upon the holding of evidence. So when we prepare a case at trial, we usually know in what jurisdiction we are going to file this case. So we know the rules of evidence. But the rules of evidence, they differ from one country, from one jurisdiction to another, and mostly from the civil law countries to common law countries. So preparing a case and having all this jurisdiction in mind is going to be a very tough, I think, challenge. where you need to be able to know how the evidence that you've collected would be worth in every single jurisdiction where you will need to file the case. I take the example of a video footage. You receive a video footage of an attack in Syria, and this could be used potentially in a case. Common law system, you need a chain of custody of the evidence. So potentially you will need an affidavit, so statements of the first person who took the video. In a civil law country, affidavits, they don't really exist. So you will need to do, I think, very difficult choices also in terms of handling of evidence. So I might stop here. There are other points, but I want to leave the floor to Ibrahim. And,
thank you.
Yes,
thank you, Benedict. I must say, if I may, that one of the reasons to be proud as member of the law faculty has to be to have been the alma mater of so many great people of trial. And frankly, it's a real reason for us to be proud of what you are doing. Thank you. Ibrahim, you have the floor.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to be here. Thank you for coming. It's very difficult to speak about this issue after 7 years from war, and today we can say it's 7 years from death. After 7 years of death, we should think about what is the quick solution for the situation in Syria. I believe it's very important to establish IIIM. It's very important to have this mechanism. But as a Syrian, I should thinking about it, not as a lawyer, because it's very difficult sometimes to find the gap between I am Syrian as a Syrian thinking, civilian Syrian as thinking as Syrian lawyer. It's very difficult for us. We wait until the end of 2016 to see IIIM. I used to be very close from the Commission of Inquiry and the Syrian team in OHCHR in Lebanon. And I have some idea about how they are working. It's one from the difficult thing which the IIIM will face. They are based here in Geneva. They aren't near Syria. They can't go to the theater of crimes. They will not allow for them to go inside to see what is going on the ground directly. They always will depend about Syrian organization, about another organization, about even the regime authority. And you can thinking about the party of conflicts, how will be honest to give you the evidence, the correct evidence, and the good information. I will not be happy if I will be working with the IIIM because of the many challenges will face me. Many of them, the first one, it's very important also that the people in Syria now feeling hopeless. Nothing can stop what is going on in Syria. The international law, international committee cannot do anything for Syrian. Even IIIM, in my mind, in my opinion, it will take 2 years at least to starting the first case. I hope it's before, but I think it will take all this time. Other issue is the IIIM will take everything which Commission of Inquiry do it as it, or will starting also make investigation about it again from the beginning? That means from 2011, that means we are talking about 7 years from work. They will starting from the beginning or now? They should thinking about which is better. For me, it's better if they are starting from the beginning, from now, not stop starting from the 2011. Because they know what they are doing by themselves, not what the other people, with my respect, all my respect for the other what they did. But because I know the natural the relation between the Commission of Inquiry, Syrian team, the United Nations bodies, how they are working, I think they will face many problems when they have the cooperation with Commission of Inquiry. Most important thing which Benedict talk about it, it's how they can protect the victims and witness. How they can protect the evidence. it's very important because if we want to speak now for any witness or victim about what is going on in Syria, less from them wanted to speak to us and to give us information. In the beginning, when we used to have any things, we found many people who wanted to give their testimony and speak about what happened for them. Now it's very difficult. Some challenge also, we can speak about it, which kind of crime they are working, will work in it. Sexual violation, sage area, many things. And they will working on specific cases or in general. They can work on the cases, depends about the perpetrators who are doing the crimes. Could you do anything for the America aircrafts or Russian aircrafts or the Iranese militia or the Turkish army? All this challenge will be. For me as a Syrian, I don't find a lot of hope. But as a lawyer, I should work in it. That's what we are doing in our work in Germany. At the same time, I am thinking about why I should give my evidence and I should give my information to IIIM, to give it them, to put it on the boxes and keep it as the Commission for Inquiry do it, or I do it what I do now in Germany. I go directly to General Prosecutor and make my complaining, and maybe I will find a result, not waiting another 2 years, 5 years, maybe less than, I don't know. But I have now open door in Switzerland, Sweden, and Germany. Maybe I can't find any result. But could I waiting for another years? I don't think that. And also, IIIM will just working in the general prosecutor here in Europe or outside Europe, in other countries which have universal jurisdiction. I used to meet Mr. Pinheiro and his main team many times in Beirut before 2015. I suggest for them, why you don't ask the Human Rights Council to get wireless mandate? Why you don't have the ability to build in cases? Why we should have new mechanism if we have the first mechanism which worked for 5 years? In my mind, as a Syrian civilian, it's just losing time. It's just to say, hey, you are an international committee, we are doing something for Syrian. But if I wanted to thinking as a lawyer, I think IIIM, it will be good step because it's coming from General Assembly, not from Human Rights Council. That will make me very encouraged to do another step, to ask General Assembly maybe, and to focus on it and make advocacy to have international court by General Assembly, if I could. Because now I think it's opened the door for this issue. It's the first time, if I'm not wrong, to have this commission like this. So I will go to General Assembly for as a Syrian lawyer and will ask IIIM to recommend this issue for the General Assembly, to ask them to have international court by them, not to Security Council, because the Security Council, you know that America will not allow for anybody to prosecute her, Russia will not allow for him, nobody will allow for to prosecute himself. As the regime will not allow for us to go to accuse him before the Syrian justice. The same will happen in Security Council. For that, I think you have a lot to do. You have some assistance, not a lot of assistance from Syrian organization, I think, because the relation between the Syrian committee NGOs and the IIIM, it will be very unclear. It will be foggy because, as I said, why we are as a Syrian NGOs working for 7 years, I will give you all what I did to you. To wait another time, I will not do that. I will waiting maybe 1 year, 2 years to see what you are doing. For me, I am talking about myself, not about the other show. I am waiting for 1 year, 2 years to see what you are doing, and after that I will thinking about how to have cooperation with you. Because I find solution now. It depends about what you are doing now and what you will doing in the short future. And after that, you can find a good corporation, I think, from Syrian organization. I speak honestly. Maybe the other will not speak for you this way, but I will speak with you honestly, because I am feeling as a civilian Syrian and as a lawyer, I am speaking the same way. We are a group. Our group is Caesar Files Group. We have the Caesar photo. Caesar is in our group also, himself. And we have other evidence, not just the photo. But we called it the same Caesar because it's like a symbol for the all Syrian defenders who can be appearance by themselves. But I will not give you directly what I have, because I don't know what this evidence will happen for it. I don't know where you will keep it. I don't know when you will use it, actually. I don't know if I wanted to take it again to Mike to make any complaining, you will give it to me. All this issue, you should thinking about it as a triple IM, and you find the solution for it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Your position, you said a lot of things with your position that the mechanism should concentrate on what happens now after 2016 and not come, it's probably very disputable, so open to discussion. Thank you very much. For the second round, first of all, every speaker will have the opportunity to react to what he or she has heard, and you have heard a lot. If I may just add one question, and you have addressed things which I wanted to be discussed already, but we can come back to the protection of witnesses, the protection of victims, etc. You, the two of you already mentioned it, but just one, sorry, technical question. The terms, I think it's a decision, bars cooperation with jurisdiction which accept trials in absentia. We don't know what the situation will be in Syria in a couple of months or years, but it's not impossible that the only possibility of having trials is to have trials in absentia. And how do you manage this condition, which is in the regulation which gave birth to your mechanism? If I may just ask this technical question, and for the rest, please react and elaborate on what you have already said.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, obviously, the terms of reference are really the guiding foundation for Triple IM. We're not like the courts and tribunals that have a statute that very clearly spells things out. So, indeed, the reference to no trials in absentia is something that forms part of the framework that we are in, unless and until that would be changed in a future situation in a different jurisdiction. So, yeah, I mean, there's not that much more I can say about it at this stage. We know, though, that, I mean, from past experience too, that even if the prospects of arrests of key suspects doesn't appear imminent, over time that can change too. So I think it is important to bear that in mind. And obviously I think we could all agree that, you know, although trials in absentia are accepted in a number of jurisdictions, we see models of international justice where they're happening, such as the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. But if we have the possibility to have trials with the accused persons in the dock, then that is always going to be preferable. Yeah, indeed, a lot of really interesting and important points raised by both of my fellow panelists here. And maybe just to react briefly to some of those that came out. I think you started off, Benedict, by talking about managing expectations, and that's absolutely one of the key priorities that has been with the IIIM from the beginning, because we know that the communities affected by the conflicts do feel a sense of hopelessness about what the prospects of justice are. We, of course, have a mandate where we can go a certain way, but we can't actually issue indictments and do those things that obviously the victim communities want. So it is very important for us to be clearly messaging what we can, what we can't do, what we are going to contribute towards the accountability process, As I started off saying, I think we can contribute a lot, even within the limited confines of our mandate, but it is very clear, very important we be clear about that. Benedict mentioned the report to the General Assembly that we have just submitted. The unofficial version is on the AAAM's website. We hope the official version will be available before the end of the month. But that's also very much a tool for us to try and communicate and to manage the expectations of the people who are most affected by this. We think that that's hugely important. You also mentioned, Benedict, the challenge of trying to deal with evidentiary matters when you don't know what jurisdictional rules will apply. You know, and of course it applies to the admission of evidence. It also applies to the case building component of the work that we do as part of our mandate. So we've been tasked to build case files, but the big questions of course are based on what legal framework, what crimes should we be looking at, what are the elements of those crimes. We know that even between customary international law and the ICC statute, for example, there are important differences in the elements to be proved, let alone all the evidentiary rules that will be very specific to the jurisdiction. So this is part of the process we're going through now in terms of developing our own internal strategy and operational guidelines, is to really try and find a formula that will allow us to really meet standards that would be applicable in as broad a range of jurisdictions as possible. So really to find those common denominator standards and approaches that will maximise the chances of this being useful. But still, we know that when we transfer evidence to a particular jurisdiction or a case file, there is going to have to be adaptation of what we've done, that's obvious. But we want to make sure that what we do is the most flexible approach to facilitate that adaptation. The question about whether to focus on the past or whether to focus on current crimes, indeed an interesting one that I would be very curious to hear other people's reactions on. But it is, of course, something that we have been looking at quite significantly. The terms of reference, I think the resolution giving rise to the IIIM was mostly focused on past crimes because of the emphasis on collecting existing documentation of creating those relationships with the Commission of Inquiry and others. But of course, as we continue to hear the news out of Ghouta, we know that crimes continue, there are allegations of massive amount of crimes ongoing now. So I think for the mechanism, it will be a combination of both. We will need to obviously go back and understand what has happened previously, but we also need to have an eye to the crimes that are ongoing now, because we have, of course, a particular opportunity to collect evidence in a timely way on those. But our methodologies might be different between the two categories. I mean, very much the past crimes, it is about taking stock of what's been done by others. For future crimes, we have an opportunity, actually, to have a dialogue and to work out ways of trying to maximise the collective results from the work being done. So we do have an opportunity to look at what is going to be the best methodology moving forward. The past, well, that's done. I mean, in terms of what's happened up until now, we can try and work with that, but the future presents some additional opportunities. I wanted to say a few words about the relationship between IIIM and national prosecutors. And again, Ibrahim, I'm really conscious of the remark you made about, you know, as a Syrian, as a lawyer, do I bother to give my material to IIIM? Why should I do that when this is a new and untested institution? I don't know what I can expect from them. Or should I just go directly to national jurisdictions where I think they could receive information from me and maybe more quickly proceed ahead? And I suppose our message is we hope you won't see those two things as mutually exclusive, actually, because we see our relationship in supporting national prosecutors with the work that they're doing as really an essential part of our mandate, and where we can very quickly add value to what is already going on now. And so that probably sounds very vague and uncertain, so let me try and make it a bit more concrete for you. What we will do with IIIM starting now is really focus on building a comprehensive evidence collection, if I can put it that way, of evidence that is relevant to prosecuting crimes committed in Syria since 2011. We have the advantage of being able to really take that broad view of the conflict, so really try to understand what are the broad crime patterns, who are the actors, what is the chronology of events, what sort of expertise is out there that might help with these prosecutions. We know from past experience you need military experts, you need forensic experts. How can we identify who those people are and start building that expertise that could be plugged into case files? So we see, if I can borrow a term that I know colleagues in some of the national jurisdictions are using, we see the need for a structural investigation to begin with, to inform the building of our evidence collection. And if we do that well, we think that we can then really be responsive to specific requests coming from national systems. So if they have an investigation ongoing and they have an evidentiary gap, they would be able to communicate with us and say, we are looking for material on this topic. Do you have something that might assist? So this is a process that is very familiar from other international justice processes. But of course, the key is building an evidence collection that would really be sophisticated, comprehensive, and cover all of the aspects that are likely to come up at national in national systems, but also in the future in international prosecutions. So we see scope for a lot of not only evidence provision to the national systems, but also other tools, analytical tools, if I can say that, because we will focus heavily on bringing analytical expertise into the IIIM's staffing makeup. And so we know that those sorts of tools that will help understand chronologies of events, will help understand the organograms of the key actors, the structures of power, who was cooperating, collaborating with who, those will be really important analytical tools that we could make available. We also know from experience that when you are prosecuting a very narrow crime, like, for example, a single incident of torture, that's something that a national system might be able to do without too much difficulty. But when you're then trying to situate that act of torture as part of a widespread or systematic attack for a crimes against humanity charge, then all of a sudden the national system is going to need evidence of the widespread or systematic attack and to understand how this crime fits within that and who the actors were. And there we also see that we could, based on our big picture view, start developing evidentiary modules, if you like, that might help with proving the contextual elements of crimes or understanding the existence of a conflict or multiple conflicts and how to prove the existence of that in order to bring forward a war crimes charge. So we have lots of ideas already about how IIIM can add value to what is being done at the national level. This is the kind of discussion that we are now having with our national prosecution counterparts. And we are also, of course, pursuing in frameworks like the Genocide Network. So I hope that provides at least a bit more food for thought. Thank you.
Yeah. Ibrahim will say he's completely satisfied right. with all the explanation. But before he says that, perhaps Benedict, and perhaps you would like to address the political challenges which the mechanism will face and react actually to what has been said.
Talking about the work with national jurisdictions. So IIIM goes around the deadlock of the Security Council, but political interference is also very often present at the national level. Many prosecuting authorities are directly under the Minister of Justice. And we know that we are here in a very politically volatile context where there are offensives from the Syrian government to try and reopen diplomatic relations. On the other way, you have intelligence being made between European countries and the Syrian governments, among other, with respect to the question of terrorism. So you might find some potential hurdles before prosecuting authorities that could have been at one point willing to prosecute those crimes and suddenly will start to get a bit slower or maybe even unwilling to work on those crimes. I take the very concrete example of the Rifat al-Assad case, the uncle of the current president. He's living in Europe since 84, and we have strong ground to think that he's one of the main perpetrators of the Hama massacre in 82. We filed a complaint 4 years ago against him before the Swiss prosecuting authorities, who opened a criminal investigation for war crimes. And since then, nothing much has happened. We have done a very thorough investigation, brought among 10 insider witnesses, among maybe 100 documentary evidence that actually points to the direction of Rifat. He's in Europe, he's between France and the UK, so he's accessible to justice. But for one reason or another, nothing much is happening. So we can see that already, for people who are not in the current government, you might find some difficulties when it gets to middle to high rank individuals. And I think that the leverage that has a UN mechanism would be potentially far better than a smaller NGO. But still, these are also challenges that the IIIM might face. And also, sometimes you could have even perpetrators that come on the territory in Europe, and that potentially will not be arrested. I'm going to take the very concrete example of Ali Mamlouk, that some of you might know. He's the chief of the security bureau, and he's on a travel ban, and he's supposed to be one of the main perpetrators, very close ally to Bashar. And we have very, very concrete evidence that he was here in Italy back in January. So what do you do when you have such difficult oppositions and different agendas that might conflict with the fight against impunity, which is supposedly a top priority for the EU? Maybe one solution could be found in the civil law countries, where you have the civil party status, which means that sometimes NGOs or victims can participate to the proceeding. So if you have a deadlock and the proceeding is not advancing, the prosecutor is not doing anything, then it might be interesting to liaise with NGOs that are used to litigate those cases, because there sometimes you can try and force the prosecutor to act. And if he doesn't act, you can appeal against his lack of action. In the same case, Rifat al-Assad, in September 2015, he came to Switzerland, came back to his luxury hotel, and we asked the prosecuting authorities to interrogate him and to arrest him, and the answer was no. So the victims filed an appeal before the Swiss Federal Criminal Court, and the Swiss Federal Criminal Court said, your attitude is not understandable, and you need to go and indict and interrogate the suspect. So there you can have a potentially interesting leverage that is in the countries where you have the civil party status.
Thank you, Benedict. So the last word for you, actually, before the discussion.
I want to speak about the litigation in Syria. We can't think that it will be impossible for at least 10 years, because all laws in Syria make impunity for the perpetrators. There is many laws for that, and the Institute for Syria also protect the presidents. It's like impossible to find any accused against Bashar al-Assad or another person who will be president. It means we should change all this, and it will take long time. And even if we want to talk about Syrian lawyers, Syrian judge, and also the building for the courts, it's not possible to do that now. It will take long time. That's what you are doing for us to prepare ourselves as Syrian lawyer for the future, because I believe that it's the most cases will be in Syria, not here in Europe or in other places. Also, I want to also again focus about something maybe the IIIM, I will suggest for them to do it. The most important for the reports from Commission of Inquiry, I think, it's the last one, which talk about their resort, because it's they are talking about specific cases, and the other one, it's about Aleppo. It's the most important things. For that, I will suggest for IIIM to focus about specific cases, not biggest subject, because it will be very useful for them to work in it. And something I challenge us also as human rights defenders or lawyers or judges who are working in this, it's how the litigation have link and it's free from the political people. As Benedict said about Ali Mamlouk, and the last year, Deep Zaytoun, he is also the head of intelligence branch in Syria, came to Italy again. Nobody did anything for that. What happened 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago in Czechia Republic with Saleh Muslim, it's make me very afraid about what is going on in the future, actually. It's always, all our work maybe will stop because the politic said, no, this man cannot stop him. At the same time, I am afraid about the Syrian activists and Syrian opposite of the regime, that the regime will using the same Interpol warrant arrest to stop them as a criminal. And what will happen for them if the politic in this country or not have cooperation with the regime like Russia or another country which have cooperation with the regime will arrest any of our Syrian activists because the regime sent his warrant arrest for the Interpol. All these things we should thinking about it because we will face it in the near future, not far future. I can't accept what happened with Saleh Muslim. Not by himself, but about the way which they'll release him. There is warrant arrest against him in Interpol. Nobody stop him. Because with my respect, European Union support him against Turkey because there is argue between Turkey and European Union, so they don't want to arrest this person and send it him for Turkey. I am afraid about what will happen in the future, new future. And Ali Mamlouk is the biggest example, and Deep Zaytoun, biggest example. We should also thinking about this, because we are governed by the political people, not by the laws.
That's a definitive statement, but okay. Thank you very much. Thank you to all the speakers who have been very disciplined, because they are eager to listen to your questions and comments. Before that, may I give the floor to Natasha Brack as a member and spokesperson of the International Bar Association's Human Rights Institute.
Thank you very much. It's going to be a very brief statement because I'm sure you have a lot of questions to ask to the panelists. So I would like first to thank the Geneva Academy for the organization of the IHL talk, which I'm very happy to see that is very well attended, and I hope you're having a very interesting time. I would like to mention just very briefly the International Bar Association's Human Rights Institute work in Syria in 2-3 sentences. We're working on accountability with Syrian lawyers on how to engage with UN mechanisms and on universal jurisdiction, how to engage with domestic courts. So this is something that we're working on. It's a 2-year project with ILAC, who is an organization under which we work. They have a very big Syria program. And they published an excellent report on the rule of law in Syria that will be available. We have a few copies if you want to take. Otherwise, it's available online. And the report is a picture of the current, actually the rule of law up until 2070, is how the judicial system was working up until then, and how Syrian organizations, Syrian lawyers, judges have been trying to maintain the rule of law in various parts of Syria. So I think it's a very good report. And I would like also to mention the new report from Trial International on universal jurisdiction, which give you a very good overview of all the universal jurisdiction cases open in the world. And they have also mentioned a few CIA cases. So if you want to know the cases that are currently being prosecuted in Europe under the universal jurisdiction principle, I invite you to look at their report. And that's all I wanted to say. I just wish you a very good afternoon. And I think we can start with the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for this presentation. The report of trial will be presented probably in an event co-organized with the Academy by the end of April. But we are looking for a date, and that's not very simple. But hopefully, it will be also a public event. Thank you. Who would like to ask a question, sir, with a blue suit? But take the mic because
sorry. Yeah, my name is Mohannad. I'm a lawyer from Syria. So as Ibrahim mentioned, today marks like the 7th anniversary of the Syrian revolution. And all the accountability efforts in the past 7 years done by the Commission of Inquiry or the other international NGO and recently by you did not get us anywhere in terms of prosecuting the war crime perpetrators, or in terms of achieving peace in Syria, and as you said, lifting the suffering of Syrian people. So my question is: do you think that your work, alongside with the Commission of Inquiry work and other international NGO, is impairing the peace process in Syria? Since you are basically collecting and investigating war crimes committed by the same parties who were sitting on negotiation tables on here in Geneva or even in Astana. So why those people would like to reach a peace settlement while they already know that they will be sent to a trial afterwards? This is my first question. Second question, if I may, I will be very concise. Yeah, it's as we said, the conflict in Syria now is involving countless parties that include state and non-state actors. So in its last report of September, the Commission of Inquiry mentioned that the U.S. Forces carried out an airstrike, killing civilians and causing damages to civilian objects in violation of the international humanitarian law rules. So, and they mentioned also that Iran and Qatar brokered the population exchange agreement in Syria, which is also constitute a war crime of forcibly displaced population. So my question is, are you going to build files against US? Are you going to build files against Qatar, Iran? What is the report did not even mention what is the role of Iran and Qatar in this agreement. They didn't even try to contacted this state, so we have no idea what their role.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Your first question is the real big question about peace and justice, but it's a real question. Just perhaps we take some questions and then you will answer to all these questions, and perhaps do as a gentleman did, just briefly introduce yourself. Thank you. Not your name, but who you are, as you did.
Hello, my name is Hannah. I'm representing the Free Syrian Lawyer Association. First of all, I have a comment about this photo, because this photo represents how the international community failed to protect the human rights in Syria. This is the green buses to displace the Syrian in this neighborhood after the destruction by Assad regime. And the only solution was to displace the Syrian civilian and make Bashar al-Assad satisfied. The first question, when Madame Michelle is speaking about the Triple LM, the evidence collection, do you think about the forensic evidence? I think there is no protection of forensic evidence in Syria, and we have to think about the other group when Bashar al-Assad will try to defend himself or the regime. They have a very good system to protect the evidence for them to defend their case. And also, when you speak about the achieving the accountability in the national level, what is the idea about the sexual violations in Syria? Actually, the national law is so weak, and women are accused by the sexual violations in Syria. And do you think about the children who were born after sexual violations by even the regime, ISIS, other party of the conflict? And also, I have a question to Mr. Ben. You were speaking about the protection of witnesses, and until now we have no protection of victims. And if we think about the accountability, first of all, we have to achieve the protection for the victims, and especially the women and children. Thank you.
Thank you. A third question before we, Madam, just behind. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Mary Grace. I work with Universal Rights Group here in Geneva. My question is about the COIs, the Commissions of Inquiry, and why they've been characterized as ineffective in ensuring accountability, and what the IIIM can do to avoid those pitfalls in the future. Thank you.
I didn't say they were inefficient. I would say they were ill-equipped for bringing evidence, because they are not specialists in criminal law, and so you don't bring evidence when you don't know the rules. But okay. Do you want to begin?
Sure. Okay, well obviously some important and difficult questions from the group. Mohammed, I think, you mentioned, of course, the big question about the relationship between justice processes and peace processes. And of course, I could and will give the obvious answer that, you know, it's not a question for IIIM to answer. We have a mandate from the General Assembly, and we are focused on that mandate. The peace process is a political process. It's happening separately from that. Of course, as an international justice practitioner, this is not an issue that you can be completely unaware of. I mean, we know that there is intensive debate and discussion about the relationship between the two concepts, and nobody wants the justice process to interfere with peace and the cessation of the suffering of the people in Syria. So I think we can all agree that these are really important pressing questions. One thing we have said in our General Assembly report, which as I mentioned has just been recently submitted, is that for IIIM at least, we are proceeding on the basis that amnesties for serious international crimes are not acceptable, and I think that is a well-established principle of international law now. But obviously, beyond that, there are a lot of things for others to debate and discuss. But in the meantime, we proceed with moving forward on the mandate that we've been given, which is to collect, consolidate, preserve, and prepare case files that could be used later on. You talked about the Commission of Inquiry's reports and the findings in those, and it's an important point, actually, and I'm glad I have the opportunity to emphasise what our position is on that. The three I's in the IIIM's mandate are, of course, international, but independent and impartial. And for us and our credibility, it is so crucial that we retain our independence and impartiality. So in terms of independence, that really means, yes, we will collect and we have to collect material that others have compiled, but it doesn't mean we will import their conclusions. We will not import the conclusions of other bodies. It is for us, for IIIM, to look at the material collected and make our own assessment based on criminal law standards about what we can conclude from that material. And as Professor Roth mentioned, the Commission of Inquiry is working under a different mandate, applying different standards. It isn't a criminal law mandate, ours is. So we are looking in a different way at the evidence, at corroboration, at what standard of proof we think the evidence could reach. And I think it's obvious that our conclusions will potentially be different in many respects. In terms of who would the IIIM or what kinds of crimes would fall within our work, our mandate is open in that respect. It's all serious crimes committed in Syria since March 2011. So for us, it will be an evidence-driven process. As any prosecutor would tell you, you know, we will look at the available evidence of crimes committed on all sides, and we, if we believe that the evidence establishes a violation, then we will obviously have the ability to build a case file on that, subject to what Benedict was saying about it's obvious we can't put material to cases together on every violation just because of the sheer scale of them. So we will have to go through a prioritisation process. Anna, was it, from the Free Syrian Lawyers? Yeah, you asked about our forensic evidence, and our approach is really all sources of evidence are of interest to us. We've seen from some of the other courts and tribunals in the past how forensic evidence can be incredibly useful. It's not always required. It depends a bit on the nature of the crimes being investigated and prosecuted and the availability of other types of evidence, but it's certainly something where we can foresee the need to have the capacity to collect forensic evidence, to have it analysed and to build that into case files as appropriate. And you also asked about you asked about sexual violence in Syria. The mechanisms mandate or terms of reference put special emphasis actually on sexual and gender-based violence crimes and also crimes against children for obvious reasons, because we know that historically these two categories of crimes haven't always been very well dealt with. I think again, here's an area where we have so many lessons learned from the ad hoc courts and tribunals over the years. So we at IIIM start with the benefit of a lot of collected experience and hard lessons learned, actually. We have in the 20 or so people we have on board at the moment, we have experts in sexual and gender-based violence in the categories of analyst, legal advisor, and also soon we will have an investigator on board. And although our approach would very much be to integrate focus on these crimes throughout the office, we know that it is important to have these focal points on gender and crimes against children so that we're constantly assessing our own progress on this and asking whether we can do better, whether we've avoided some of the misconceptions, the traps that have reduced the effectiveness of work on these crimes before. So this is indeed a very big priority for us. And maybe just a last word on the Commission of Inquiry. I think it was the question from the other speaker about why have they been ineffective. And indeed, as with Professor Roth, I think it's just important to understand the different nature of the mandate for the Commission of Inquiry. I mean, it is very much about having a forum to collect broad patterns of information about broad patterns of violations, to be able to report on that publicly, and at least traditionally hasn't focused so much on linking those violations to specific alleged perpetrators, which is why the IIIM's been set up as a separate institution, because the focus for us really is on that linkage part of the step and to apply criminal law methods. We won't report publicly on the substantive work that we do, so you won't hear from IIIM in its reports what cases it is working on. That will remain confidential for operational reasons. So you can see the very different functions that the Commission has on the one hand and the mechanism will have on the other.
Regarding your question about witness and victims, I think it's a good point. It's because sometimes I think when we speak in legal terms, we tend to have a kind of a cold vocabulary, but so witness protection encompasses as well victim protection. So by saying victim witness protection, I was also mentioning, or I wanted to mention as well, the victims when you have in a case in France or in Switzerland, civil parties, they are considered as well people that can benefit from witness protection schemes. There are always questions whether they are granted this protection. It's not always straightforward, but we always try to have as well the victims
who are sometimes witnesses as well, protected in the same way. So it all depends on the jurisdiction. You have different type of protection depending on the jurisdiction, but often the protection comes from the beginning. If you start as a witness or as a victim, you will request to have. There is a whole set of protection that is implemented in the laws. So, for instance, talking about Switzerland, you have a law on witnesses, which also talks about victims, so you can have your anonymity during the initial stage until the end of the trial. If it's required, you can also have relocation possibilities, etc. So there is a whole set of measures, but it all depends on the jurisdiction. And yes, it starts from the beginning, because the aim is to prevent the suspect to know who's the person who's speaking and who's giving the testimony.
No, I think the third question is around Michelle.
Okay, then we open if you... Okay, the second round of questions. The gentleman has been very patient up there. And then we go down. Thank you. And short questions, if possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Darren, I'm from the Geneva Academy as an LLM candidate. Two brief questions. Can the panelists shed any light on what the mechanism can propose or is proposing to Syrian civil society so that they can have more of a two-way rather than a one-way relationship? And the second question is more for Madame Jarvis on potential interactions between the UNSC established investigative team on crimes committed by ISIL in Iraq. So relations between that team and the mechanism, is that plausible, feasible, practicable? Thank you.
That's a very interesting question. Thank you, sir. Yeah. The other side, I'm sorry.
No, it's fine.
A bit of exercise.
Good afternoon, and thank you for the excellent panel discussion. My name is Zoltan Turbek. I'm a legal officer at WHO. I was in New York when the GA resolution on the establishment was established. I was one of the legal advisors at the permanent mission. I have two pragmatic questions. One is related to funding, and the other is access to the Syrian territory. Until now, the mechanism has been working on voluntary funding, right? But the SG was requested to include include the necessary funding in his budget proposal. How do you see the future of the funding? Are you optimistic about finding a sustainable, stable funding for the mechanism? And the second question, very quick, what steps the mechanism intends to take in order to access to have access to the Syrian territory. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So, Abdullahi Sayed, the Syrian lawyer. Quick comment and a quick question to Ms. Jarvis. The comment is really for the whole panel. It speaks to the discussion. Seen from the perspective of a Syrian lawyer, I think that the importance and the function of the IIIM is not only the linkage between the crime-based to the evidence to the perpetrators, but also the possibility that we have a forum that, in fact, verifies and validates evidence massive evidence that is out there, and this is very important for all other fora. My question is relates really to the victims, and I know that the terms of reference speaks about access given to victims for adequate remedy. Now, I don't know how is that going to play out in the work of the IIIM. Does the IIIM contemplate procedures allowing victims to access, require investigations into specific crimes or incidents? And if that's so, what is the thinking? Thank you.
Thank you. So, are you ready to begin, or do you want to?
Yes.
A small break.
Okay. All right. I think the first question, Darren from Geneva Academy, Syrian civil society and the two-way communication process. Yes, this is very much, I think, part of what I was talking about in my introduction, about acknowledging more concretely than has been the case before about the important role that civil society plays in accountability. So it's definitely something that we have been working on. We've been consulting quite extensively with Syrian NGOs and civil society more broadly, and we've heard a lot of ideas and suggestions and recommendations. So that's been an important part of the process for us, is to hear what the views currently are. We have established a platform for dialogue with Syrian NGOs in particular, which has happened already twice in Lausanne, and the third installation of that will be in April. So we will keep meeting. The plan is every 6 months to have that dialogue with Syrian NGOs specifically. The kinds of things that we've heard from NGOs about what they're unhappy about from the past and what they would want moving forward concerns things like feedback on the kind of material that they're handing over. Was it helpful? Did it get used? How could we improve our methods? And I think it's obvious that as IIIM, given that we are reliant on other document collectors, we also have a big interest in making sure that people who are doing that work do understand how to maximise the effectiveness of that work. So we are open to having that discussion and dialogue with Syrian NGOs, with other parts of civil society. It's true that because we're working with a criminal law methodology, it is very specific. You know, in national systems, I think, Benedict, you were alluding to this, civil society doesn't get involved in criminal investigations. So this is a very different framework. So if we can really have a constructive dialogue and discussion about, you know, things to avoid doing when you are collecting evidence so that you avoid the risk of contaminating evidence, so everybody understands what chain of custody means and what people working in law enforcement context would need in terms of information about how a piece of evidence was collected. It's obvious that we don't want to convey the impression that civil society need to turn into criminal law investigators. I don't think that's the model that anyone has in mind. But given the reality that a lot of this documentation is coming from civil society, and it has to because of the lack of access, resources, then we really all have an interest in making sure that it's done as well as possible and that the collective results are maximised. So that is what we can certainly commit to in terms of a two-way exchange, and will certainly be part of our dialogues coming up in Lausanne in April. The UN investigation team in Iraq, of course, it's early days for that, but it's obvious that there will be overlap in the focus of the IIIM and the Iraq investigation mission. You know, we anticipate that we will each be collecting information that will be of relevance to the other, so there needs to be discussion and consideration of the relationship between the two, but it's really too early to comment on it more than that at this stage. There are differences, of course, in the mandate, the various mandates. The Iraq investigation mission is a hybrid structure with international and Iraqi personnel.
IIIM in its mandate obviously also has limitations in addition to the limitation about trials in absentia. It's clear that we are restricted in terms of sharing material with jurisdictions that apply the death penalty. So these are all issues that will have to be explored as we move forward on this. Funding from the colleague from WHO, indeed it is a big challenge when you have any kind of accountability related mechanism on voluntary funding. We know that from the models in Sierra Leone, in Cambodia, the Special Tribunal for Lebanon, indeed.
Yes.
So we know that often what happens is a lot of work and resources go into raising funds to keep going instead of into the substantive work. So we definitely want to avoid that sort of a scenario. I think currently the funding situation for IIIM does reflect real support for the accountability issue in Syria, so that's encouraging. And we are optimistic that we will continue to have that sort of outpouring of support, but we know that we can't be blasé about that, that priorities change and things shift. So we obviously need to have strategies in place to make sure we keep leveraging the support that is out there. It is hard, actually, in that, of course, within the terms of our mandate, we are bound by confidentiality on our substantive work, so you won't see reports on cases and that sort of thing. We won't issue indictments. We won't have those big events that people take notice of and say, okay, you know, this is what IIIM is doing. So our outreach and our communication with the international community is going to have to be different from that. So it is a challenge for IIIM to demonstrate impact, but I think I've said enough today to show we do have ideas about that and how we can do that. So we are optimistic. But indeed, the General Assembly's resolution requesting the Secretary General, or calling upon, I think is the language, to make a regular budget proposal for IIIM is a positive development. We will have to see what happens with that. We know the process through the UN budget committees is of course not straightforward. So we'll have to see what happens with that in the coming months. But yes, I think we are at least optimistic. So, and then I think the final question was, if I understood it correctly, it was about to what extent can victims, did you mean to sort of trigger processes through the IIIM, or I'm not...
Yes, access, direct access by a victim to the IIIM.
Yeah.
Are there procedures for that? Are they compensated at all?
Yes.
So what are the parameters of action? Because this is important. I think that this speaks to the whole question about whether or not the IIIM is victim-oriented. So
yes. Yes. I mean, of course, it's different from a court system where you might see very formal mechanisms for victims to participate as parties in the proceedings. So obviously for us, that's not a question. But we have committed very strongly to a victim-centred approach, and it is important in this early formative phase that we really give concrete meaning to what that means, what that looks like. We certainly envisage dialogue with victims' groups, with victims' representatives. We want to hear what their priority concerns are. We think that that will help us inform our own strategic prioritisation. Just to give you an example from past experience, you know, questions have been raised about, for victims, is it more important to see direct perpetrators prosecuted or senior level perpetrators prosecuted? And I would say, based on the dialogues I've had with victims' groups in the former Yugoslavia, it's obvious that they want accountability of both groups of perpetrators. But those are questions that we want to hear from victims, groups and representatives on, and that's just one example of where we think there's a real need to make sure that we are hearing the voices of victims. Of course, victim-centred approach is also very much bound up in the issues of protection and security and making sure that we have solid systems in place for that, and that we aren't, as international justice actors, making our own assumptions about what victims want, but that we have the opportunity to hear from them and offer choices
talk. So we can take a last round of questions, beginning with the coordinator of IHA Talk, Isabella. Even shorter than the previous ones.
Just two quick questions. The first one is, I'm wondering what happens with the rule of foreign state, foreign officials' immunity, which does not protect them while before an international tribunal. But since you are focusing on the work of domestic prosecution, then it will become an issue. So what will happen, I'm afraid that what will happen at the end of the road is that most of these prosecutions will target members of non-state armed groups. And then, so the majority of these cases will concern armed groups member, and the mechanism won't be seen as so very much impartial to them at least, and it will also cause a problem with regard to peace negotiations because they must be also sitting at the table. And my second question, perhaps for Ibrahim and Benedict, is what happens with civil law litigations? Are these a path which might be also useful to address the impunity accountability in Syria? I'm thinking about the Alien Claim Tort Act in the US, but there are other ways also of claiming accountability, not only at the criminal level, but also at the civil level, and it might raise it might bring a solution in the sense that the prosecutorial discretion might be not present in civil law cases, and is this a useful mean to address accountability in Syria as well?
Thank you. You can give directly to the gentleman behind.
Hello, Guillaume Fournier from the International Institute of Humanitarian Law. My question was, what is the legality of courts in the Kurdish part of Syria, since it's not a state and it's not recognized as part of Syria, really?
The Kurdish.
And also, what law will be applied in these governments, and what guarantees of impartiality and independence in these courts?
Okay, and the last here, madam. Sorry, we have to go around.
Hello, I'm Lorraine Anderson from the Canadian Mission. And I have a question with regard to confidentiality. You actually answered the first part of my question, but the second part of my question has to do with how you're dealing with states in terms of some have legislation with regard to how they can transfer information and case files. Are you finding that to be a challenge, or are you able to work out agreements with states in order that they're able to transfer information of the case files that they're building, and what is the approach that you're developing in that regard?
Thank you. Please.
Yes, the first question about head of state immunity. Indeed, if IIIM's work was only focused on national proceedings, then I would agree with you that that's potentially a problem. But of course it isn't. So in addition to jurisdictions that might currently exist, we've been asked to build case files for jurisdictions that might exist in the future. And so there we are very much thinking of the possibility of some kind of either international tribunal or a referral to the ICC or some mechanism where, you know, there would really be the possibility to try all sorts of different cases. So for us, in terms of the work we're doing, we are very much building those cases on the assumption that jurisdictional pathways might open up in the future. But it is an important general point, the impartiality aspect of our mandate. To give meaning to that, we have to be very clear about the fact that we will prioritise developing case files across the spectrum. So we're not, and we cannot just focus on violations committed on one side or against victims from one side. We need to develop cases that cover the full range of violations, and that's what we are committed to doing. The question about the Kurdish courts, I think I couldn't really offer a comment on that, but perhaps some of the colleagues may be able to do that. In terms of, I think the question from the colleague at the Canadian Mission about procedures for transferring information. Absolutely, this is a, you know, part of setting up the operational system that we will need in order to be to achieve what we hope to achieve, it varies enormously depending on the states in question. We know that some states have already flagged they don't need any particular new legislation in order to cooperate with IIIM. So, of course, for us, that is great. I mean, procedures that give us maximum flexibility is always what we will like. But we do understand that for some states, their frameworks are different from that, and that we may need to go through a process of, or they may need legislative reform to begin with, or we may need to discuss particular MOUs or procedures to put in place. Again, I think that's quite a familiar practice from the other courts, the courts and tribunals in the past. So that's certainly something that we're working on as needed when the issues come up.
Maybe just coming back to the question of immunities, I agree with you. It might be a big challenge, but in a way, you could also have many instances where you have defectors, for instance, who travel, who are living in Europe and who might not have the benefits of the immunity. Also, people coming on private visits, and there, the question of Ali Mamlouk coming on a private jet to meet the chief of the Italian intelligence, is it an official visit or not? That might be an interesting question. Regarding civil lawsuits, in the US, they are already starting. You have some colleagues who are the CJA, NGO, doing similar work to, not CJA, CJA, doing similar work to trial. They filed already cases in the US against the Syrian regime for the death of the journalist Marie Colvin. In Europe, I mean, in civil law jurisdiction, it might be a bit difficult, first because the judges will not have a prosecuting, way to deal with the case, so they will not investigate the case, will need to bring all the evidence, so that's one of the difficulties. Second, you need to bring a lot of money to start that kind of cases, which makes it also difficult. And then which law applies, and often it's the law where the illicit act was committed. So if you need to use Syrian law for those cases, it might make it a bit difficult. But in common law countries, I see it as a good way forward. The question about what laws would be used in national courts, that was your question? To have courts in the Kurdish part. I don't know if they have universal jurisdiction. I don't know exactly. I cannot really answer to this question. Maybe you can. I think that's it.
Thank you. For the Kurdish court, they don't have the universal jurisdiction, because they know what they are doing. It's the same like the regime. They always prepare themselves that they are doing well, better than the other party. They are always give the idea about they are very democratic people, but the same in the ground, the same. They committed the same crimes, but the difference between them and the other party, when they attacked any area, just ask the soldier, give me your mobile, just. And they make the same idea with the regime do it. They siege area, don't allow for anybody from other ethnic to go inside this area. Like, they didn't allow for any Arabian activists to go inside Kurdish area. For that, don't accept from them to be better than the other party. In the fact, actually, that's the problem. The old party will not allow for anybody to prosecute them. So they will not prosecute themselves in general. I think it's for civil law, Benedict answer for international cases, but I can't speak to you about what is going on in Syria now for these things.
the regime in each country, in each city, make like small committee to give like some thing to the people who destroyed their houses. But it mean nothing because it's very less, don't like what happened for their houses. That mean he is thinking for the future. If anybody wanted in the future to take another money for this, he will say there, you take this, your money. You can't take it, ask it again, because the Syrian, you as any less, you can't ask it for the same thing twice. The regime in 7 years make laws more than 20 years actually, in 7 years, 2011 until now. He is preparing for the future, not just for this 7 years. He is thinking about what is going on for the accountability, not for 7 years. And don't think he isn't care about what is going on in this international cases. When Caesar escaped from Syria, he established committee from the lawyers and judge to study this case, this photo, how is it important or not. And you know, he is sending his lawyer to raise the snatch against his men and before the European Court for Human Rights, as Hamsho and Ayman Jaber, and even Hafez Makhlouf, he tried to delete all this snatch against him. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm sorry, I will first. That was. No, you're right under international law, it's Syria. Okay, no, you're completely right. Thank you. I'm sorry to frustrate some persons in the audience, but I don't want to frustrate the students who have courses now and diplomats who have appointments. So I would like to thank warmly the panelists for their presentations. A lot the information which was provided, which has been very, very substantial. Thank you to your audience. Thank you to Anna Kivada, who has assisted in this event, and the other staff of the Academy. Thanks to the Human Rights Institute of the International Bar Association for this cooperation. And I wish you a very good afternoon. Yeah, exactly. In 2 or 3 days, I don't know why, but they need 2 or 3 days in order to upload and prepare. So next week. Thank you.
travail, mais dans 4-5 jours, parce que cette catène a le charme, je sais très bien ce qu'elle fait. Miguel Oural veut devenir quoi? Il est encore jeune. Miguel.